Hachette Audio presents Ymir, written by Rich Larson, read by Alan Medcroft. Chapter 00. An enormous, rust-brown bowl ship, pitted and scarred from its journey, descends through Ymir's dark, howling sky. Drones stream upward from the ice field to meet it, swarming like insects, tasting its hull with electromagnetic mouths and asking after its cargo. The bowl ship reports nickel alloy, raw hydrogen, an inconsequential amount of human freight. When it sinks into the frost-coated docking cradle, the heat of its stabilizers turns ice to vapor. A thunderhead of steam slams out in all directions. The bowl ship groans and shudders and finally comes to rest. It opens itself to the tunnels below, where automated laborers and exoskeled dockhands await to begin unloading. Past the alloy stores, past the hydrogen tanks, in the darkest gut of the ship, the torpor pool. Bodies churn in a slow current around the reactor, tangling and untangling, a drifting mass of frosty flesh. They are skeletal, emaciated from the long haul, and their skins are coated a slick milky white by the stasis fluid. They are clinically dead, but not legally corpses. At the far end of the pool, a door folds open. Two dockhands step through in a gush of steam. One is carrying a long hooked pole on her shoulder. A tiny drone is clinging to the end. "Rerouted the whole ship for one fucking body," she says. "Must be a company man."
"We giving him a private thaw, then?"
"Sending him straight north. They'll thaw him on the way." The drone darts ahead of them, fairy-like on gossamer rotors. Its scarlet laser plays over the drifting bodies. The dockhands wait while a spiny walkway assembles itself, sprouting from the reddish-brown wall to extend across the torpor pool. They trudge forward, footsteps echoing in the cathedralic space. The drone slides under the surface of the pool with a muted gurgle. The dockhands follow its red light, and the one with the pole slings it off her shoulder. She eases it into the stasis fluid, poking between bodies until the magnetic hook finds a particular harness. Together, the dockhands dredge their catch up out of the pool. The walkway grows a socket to hold the base of the pole. It slides inside with a rasp and click, and the man is hoisted into the air like a puppet, dripping fluid. The dockhands peer at him. He's small, pallid-skinned, and dark-haired. He has no lower jaw. Between the blue curve of his upper lip and the rippled flesh of his throat, there is nothing but medical membrane.
"Ugly fucker," the first dockhand says.
She points to a geometric spiral on his neck, the biotech tattoo the drone scanned to identify him.
"Company man, though. I was right."
"Looks a bit like you," the other dockhand blinks. "Sending him north, you said? Maybe he a cold blood then. A cold blood company man."
"No such thing."
But when they load the body into a drifting sarcophagus for transport, she sees shins and feet cratered with scars. Her black eyes widen, then narrow, and then she spits. It trickles down the side of the man's frozen face.
"What's that about then?"
She stares down at the body.
"No such thing as a cold-blood company man," she says. "Only traitors."
"So,
I was right, he smirks. Them cold blood gene prints are real distinct. Sealy, yeah? Half, maybe. Half blood.
She hinges the sarcophagus shut.
Company's mad to send him north. He'll be leaving in a spray bag.
They guide the body across the dark walkway, over the torpor pool, following the dancing drone.
Chapter 01. Yorick wakes up dead, which is never comfortable. His chest is a clamp, lungs frozen, no heartbeat. His limbs are phantom. The hindbrain panic swallows him whole. He knows nothing except that he is alone and terrified and in the dark. Every sensory-starved nerve in his body is screaming it. And then a jolt of electricity digs its teeth in, and his heart stutters back into motion. He owns his chest muscles again, so he sucks down a breath, ballooning all the crumpled alveoli in his lungs. The first one always feels like sucking back broken glass. A rehearsed thought comes to him. Nothing is wrong. You're coming out of torpor. Nothing is wrong. You're coming out of torpor. He gasps, bucks, waits for the firestorm in his nervous system to subside, for the world to stop lurching from side to side. He works on proprioception, finding his body in space. His arms and legs are spread-eagled, punctured in a dozen places by tubes that are pumping him full of newly brewed blood. A diagnostic droid is scuttling up and down his torso. His prosthetic mandible is missing. Cold, dry air rasps in his wound.
Welcome back from the River Styx, Yorick.
Yorick's eyes are crusted over. He works his lids until he manages to free one from the gound. First, he sees only a dark grey haze. Next, he sees an orange blur flickering through his field of vision too quickly to track. He knows from experience that this is the orange suit of a Thor technician.
It's been a long time since we spoke last, the voice says. Nearly 2 decades here, half that for you, I believe, with all the time spent in torpor. I can see you've done good work in that span. 8 successful hunts. Do they ever permit you to keep trophies from them?
Yorick knows the voice. His gut coils tight.
I still think you did your very best work right here with me, of course, the voice continues. Back in those early days of subjugation.
The tattoo on his neck prickles. He knows the voice. But it was one he never thought he would hear again. And if he's hearing it again, it means,
I'm afraid this thaw's not taking place on Moonin. You were rerouted in transit to solve a more pressing problem here on Ymir.
No. No, no, fucking no.
That seems to have spiked your adrenals, Yorick. Thrilled to be home, I expect.
Memories crash in. Phosphorescent flares lighting up the ice field. The skull-pulping sound of smart minds going off. An anonymous body shredded to pieces. Steaming. Another barely intact. Wriggling through the snow and slicking blood behind. And the owner of the voice is there, too. One bony hand on his shoulder, saying, civilization costs.
I'm an administrator here now, Gouster says, voice sintered with faint surprise, as if she's still marveling at the fact.
living just to the east of your old haunts, overseeing security for all of Ymir's northern hemisphere extraction and refinery sites. Which brings us to why you're here. Yorick.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.